Greetings, my name is Vincent, and in this episode I'm very excited to announce a new series that is coming to the channel, and it's going to be called Pages to Paint. What might that be? Well, I'll be looking through all of the pages of the Epic 40K magazines and rulebooks that I have, and I'll be looking out for those wonderful photographs of all of the Epic 40K models. And then I'm going to make it my job to try and match the paint jobs that are in said publications. So let's get started with the Epic 40K 3rd Edition Battles book. On page 25, there's a very quick tutorial about how to paint an orc battle wagon. And I'm going to try and paint it here at Bunker 6. And here is the paint guide for the Orc Battle Wagon from the Battles Book of the 3rd Edition Epic 40K box set game. This is a wonderful book if you can get a hold of it. It's got some lovely images in it. This model was actually secondhand, so I'm just doing a new coat of primer over everything that was already there. Thankfully, the paint that was there wasn't too chunky, so I decided I could just paint over the top of it. Once I was done with priming, I then went on to the red colour. I decided to do a red through the airbrush rather than with the paintbrush because painting red over black can be quite time consuming, so the airbrush made quick work of this. I'd say it only took about 2 coats. Between each coat, I used the hairdryer to quicken up the process. And once the chassis and the turret were painted, I then moved on to my favourite secret weapon for painting red, which is my transparent layer. This paint, as it suggests, is quite transparent, but when you put it over the top of the flat red, it gives you this really lovely, deep, almost telephone box red, if you know what I'm talking about. It's lovely. This is the same paint technique that I'll be using for my Imperator Titan painting video when we get to that. Then I moved on to the black parts. I'm using a Baden black, but of course you can use any black paint you like. It's pretty self-explanatory. It's obviously not a particularly complex model, so I'm just making my way through all the base coat layers first. And the black seemed like the most logical thing to move to next. Going back over the red with black only took a couple of coats. Now I'm moving on to the panel lining. Obviously there isn't too much panel lining work here, just around the top of the turret door. I'm using a size 0 brush for these panel lines. Of course, you can use a wash if you prefer. Then once I'd finished blocking out certain areas, I then moved on to painting the silver metallic base coat. We are going to be adding a wash and a highlight to the silver, but this is the starting point. Normally I'd use Vallejo metal colour steel, but in this instance I thought I'd try something new. So I've moved over to Vallejo model colour gunmetal grey, and although it's thicker, I still quite like the final tone. And once I was done with blocking out all these silver areas, I moved on to doing the yellow sections. There obviously isn't too many, there's just the flames and the little icon on the side of the turret. I started with Avalan Sunset because it's a lovely base colour for yellows, and then I moved on to doing the shade and the highlights with Yero Yellow and Cassandora Yellow. Once I was finished with the yellow block, I moved over to the flames, but I had some issues because my Avalan Sunset was getting quite thick, so I had to thin it down quite a lot so it wasn't too bumpy of a finish, because of course we don't want any bumps when we move on to doing the shade sections. Also bear in mind that all of these clips are being played at 200%, meaning they're twice as fast as they were when they were initially recorded. So these flame sections actually took much longer than I expected. One, because the Avalan Sunset was just not really playing nice with me. And two, I was just having an issue finding a shape that I was happy with that looked sort of like a hot rod. And I wasn't too happy with the actual flames that were used in the source material. So I had to come up with something that I liked, that looked cool. And I finally got there in the end, but then of course I had to work on the other side too. And I didn't want it to be exactly the same, but also not too far away from the other side either. So there was a lot to think about considering it's such a small tank, but I got there in the end. And once I was finished with doing the base coat yellow of the flames, I then moved to do the black outlines of the flames. If you're ever stuck with something like doing flames, always just go on Google or Pinterest and look up flame jobs or hot rods or things like that, and you'll get lots of inspiration. There are a couple of rules that actually can make some very uniform type of flames. I can't obviously explain that audibly, but I'm sure you'll start finding some guides online quite quickly if you look it up. Once I was happy with the flames, I then moved on to painting the couple of horns that were supposed to be on top of this yellow square. But of course, there was shading and highlights added to the yellow square, which I'll show you in the next shot. All I did to create some depth for the yellow square is get some Cassandora yellow and drag it to the base of the square, treating it like a glaze, doing it a couple of times, adding some depth and some richness, and to increase the contrast, I then dragged up some real yellow to the top of the square, leaving the Overland Sunset in the middle as my mid-tone. Once I was satisfied with my little yellow square, I moved over to my little yellow flames, where I used the Cassadore yellow and pulled it into the middle of the flame, and then made sure the Uriel yellow sat on the outside of the flames to create that same sort of contrast. And if you had any outline issues, you can always use these paints like the Uriel yellow layer to actually tidy up the black edge or vice versa. You don't need to stress yourself out by worrying that you can't get things tidy. You can always go back over things, but just bear in mind, it's much easier to fix a mistake with black paint than it is to fix with yellow paint. Now, I wasn't particularly happy with how the Cassadore yellow glazing was happening in the middle of this flame on this side of the tank. I did actually end up fixing that later off camera, but just letting you know that I did notice how bad that looked. And anyway, moving on to the shade section of the metallic silver, this is a pretty no-brainer section, just using Null Null quite generously on the areas where I think it's appropriate. One thing I have noticed with some of the Vallejo metallic paints, not all of them, but some of them, is that the metallic flake can actually come back off again when you start putting washes and stuff like that over the top. So be careful with that, because you obviously don't want metallic flakes contaminating some of your other paints. One way of resolving that is just add a layer of varnish over those metallics before you start adding any washes. Now I'm just doing some edge highlighting for the red sections. If you do make any mistakes, just hit it with the flat red on the edge again, and then doing a transparent red layer again just to make things really tidy and keep things thin. The thinner you can keep those edge highlights, the more realistic and neater it will look. Now the keen-eyed of you out there will actually see some of those metallic flakes have already come off and are sitting on the top of the tank. That was from my hand leaning up against the track which had just been painted, and then moving my hand to the top of the tank. I'm not too worried about that, because actually the turret's going to be sitting on top of that section, so you wouldn't even see it anyway. But make sure that you use that varnish, like I said, because as you can see, those metallic flakes do come off. Now I wanted a bluey black highlight rather than a grey black highlight, so I'm using Dark Reaper as my first highlight up from the black, and we'll be adding more and more lighter blues as we go along. Personally, I like the idea of doing every single edge with this Dark Reaper and then being more selective later with the lighter highlights. So that's what we're going to do. If there's any mistakes, you can always just go back in with some black to tidy things up. I then moved on to the secondary highlight, which is just rust gray, making sure that I focus in on those corners and the center of edges just to make things seem more emphatic. If you ever feel that things are getting a bit too unrealistic, you can always go back in with the darker previous highlight just to blend things up a little bit more. And once I was happy with that and tidied everything up, I moved on to the final highlight, which is basically the flash highlight, where it's the brightest points of each of these black highlights. And it's going to be using 50-50 mix of rust gray and bold titanium white by Acryl Pro. Now, you don't have to use that particular white. You can use any white you can find. You just want to make sure that the lightest color you're left with is a very light bluey gray for that final highlight of the black sections. Now, this is some Bunker 6 improvisation here, but I decided that I wanted my battle wagon to look a little bit more orky. So I went in with some rust. Obviously, it's not an actual rust paint, but it's a nice simple process of using just a brown and orange paint instead. It can save you a bit of money, because then you don't need to buy a technical paint or any of the specialist paints from, say, AK Interactive, although they are very good. The only problem with specialist paints like that sometimes is they're generally enamel-based, and so you don't really want to have to go through the rigmarole of glossing the model and then going back in with the enamels later. This is just a nice quick and dirty process instead. And now I'm hitting it with the Troll Slayer Orange, as mentioned. We're just making sure that we don't do as much of this as we did with the Scrag Brown, because we want this to be sort of implying that the rustiest parts are sitting in the deepest crevices of the outer brown area. And to kill two birds with one stone, I'm doing my final silver highlight as a cleanup and as a silver highlight. So I'm just going around areas where I think that the Scrag Brown and the orange might have been a little bit too intense, just making sure that the silver highlights also just kind of minimizing some of those areas while also pulling out some of the highest points that I want to highlight on the metallic silver sections. I will say that it's definitely a case of less is more with any of the silver highlights you do here. You don't want things to start looking too bright, because of course this is an orc battle wagon. We still want things to look dark and dirty, so just go quite sparingly with any of the silver highlight paints that you may end up using. I'd recommend Runefang Steel here if you have a GW color that you can work with. And we finished painting the model. Now it's just a case of doing the most complex assembly in history, putting the two pieces together, sticking it on a stand, and doing a nice 360 shot for the end of the video. And here we are, from pages to paint. If you made it as far through the video, as always, thank you so much for watching until the end. But more importantly, thank you so much for watching to the end of a debut Pages to Paint episode. We've got many more of these to shoot, of course. If you know anything about Epic 40K, there's plenty of models to paint. So we'll be cracking on with those. I've got a few other things up my sleeve, some pretty cool surprises that I haven't announced yet. Some of them involve being in space, so I'll let you figure that one out. But, as always, until next time, I'm signing off from here at Bunker 6.